at least perturbatively they're completely irrelevant. But when we are right there, it's sort of like a metallic critical point in the sense that the density of states is actually finite. Okay, so just like, you know, there is no Fermi surface, so it's, you know, extremely simple compared to what Erez was talking about. But it's a simple example of a metallic critical point where the density of states is finite at this one point at the moment, at the gamma function. So now you can ask, well, what are interactions going to do? Okay, so perturbatively we know that, you know, here they're irrelevant, there is a gap. Here they're irrelevant, there is a gap. Okay, but right here they're not irrelevant. It turns out that, you know, if you just do scaling, they're basically marginal, but it turns out they're marginally relevant if one actually goes to the next order, they're actually marginally relevant. So one can write out sort of what the, you know, the flow equations are. So there are two, so it looks like a problem where we have, can I get the lights on? So this problem, one can sort of just analyze it. I mean, this is a fun, it's just like a simple enough problem that you can sort of work it out. So the problem is one where, you know, there is some kinetic energy. So I can sort of try and write down the Green's functions for propagating particles in some matrix. And let's label up and down for pseudo spin or this orbital degree of freedom here. Think of it like some pseudo spin. So now you have sort of Green's functions for, you know, you can have an up particle that sort of stays up as it propagates. But you can have, you know, all the diagonal Green's functions, but there are also off-diagonal Green's functions of this one. So you can sort of have some matrix Green's function where your spin can start off in any one of the two states and sort of end up in any one of the two states. But because this is a completely local interaction that we are thinking about, there is only one interaction in the problem, which is just the Hubbard U, if you want to. So you can sort of have an interaction where I have an up and down pseudo spin and you sort of end up with it. And now one can try and do a calculation within the renormalization group, which says, well, I'm going to try and progressively integrate out electrons away from this one point. So this is much simpler than trying to integrate out electrons away from, let's say, a generic Fermi surface where there's many, many momentum points on the Fermi surface. Here we are just kind of trying to integrate out things away from this one point. Okay. And so what we want to work out is, you know, how does this mass here get renormalized, let me actually sketch. So there is, you know, you want to sort of try and figure out how this, you know, will renormalize, you know, the Green's functions. But then there are various kinds of, you know, vertices that you can sort of draw to second order, which is to order, so let me call this G, then to order G square. There are various terms here where I can sort of start with up and down and end up with up and down. And there are many sort of possibilities here. You can have, you know, up, up, or you can have, you know, vertices where, you know, you can, okay, so the way I've drawn it, maybe not, but, you know, you can sort of have different Green's functions that enter here, where you can sort of flip sign and sort of, you know, so for example, I could have an up here and a down there, and have an up there and a down here. Right? So you can have Green's functions of various sorts which either conserve spin as they move or don't conserve spin. And so there are various sets of diagrams one has to put together to figure out sort of what the how the interactions and how this distance to the critical point renormalizes, but it's a simple enough exercise in this case. And that tells us that, okay, there is some renormalization of this R, which is the distance to the critical point, and there's some renormalization of the interaction string, which goes like U squared. Sorry, I was calling it G earlier, but it's kind of what I was calling U. So this tells you that there is kind of a BCS-like instability where, you know, you're going to get a flow away to large values of this repulsion. So this tells you that on either side you're stable, but right at the critical point you're unstable. Okay? Which means, of course, if I have finite fixed interaction strength, there's a finite window around that underlying critical point which will be driven unstable. Okay? So what do we get from here? What we have then is a new phase that emerges around this point. Okay? So that's going to be the picture, that there's a new phase that's going to emerge right around this particular point. And in this case, it turns out that this phase is something that breaks the rotation symmetry of the problem. Okay? So there's just one relevant direction. There's only one coupling here, G, and it sort of increases. And then you can sort of ask, well, what does that coupling G do? This G, I can decompose it, and it will give me some generic magnetization in the pseudo-spin space. Okay. Now you can ask, well, where does that magnetization point? Everything is happening at the gamma point, first of all. So the pseudo-spin has to point, it has to be completely uniform in space. Okay. But now I have to pick what direction is this ferromagnetic pseudo-spin going to point in. It can point along the Z direction, which is a Z magnetization here. But that you see is only going to renormalize the distance to the critical point. So if I imagine this gap here, the Zeeman gap, which I'm saying has to go to zero to get this band inversion, if I put in some magnetization here, this point is just going to move around. But if you make a transverse magnetization, it turns out that's a real order parameter. And this transverse magnetization breaks the rotational symmetry of the problem. So for example, these off-diagonal elements, we had this winding number 2, which means close to the gamma point, it will sort of look like e to the I 2 theta. So this means that if you sort of go rotate around in momentum space, there is a very specific winding that happens. But now, if you put in some fixed magnetization here, it's going to break that rotational symmetry of the problem. So what this does is, in fact, what it gives you is a nematic order, which persists to finite temperature, some discrete order parameter, just like, would have been true even in an O2 system. In this case, it's just a discrete Z3 order parameter because there are three possible choices of the triangular lattice. It's a nematic order that persists to finite temperature. So what happens now is, here you have a quantum Hall transition that we kind of started with nothing going on at finite temperature. There's no finite temperature transition at all. But now, if we turn on interactions, there's this finite dome of nematic that exists in the problem, which completely masks this underlying critical point. Yeah.
So, after all, in the paper,
there
was mentioned that the
Right. So, if you take a system which has time reversal symmetry to begin with, then there are multiple directions in which it can be unstable. So it can either have a nematic instability, and what the nematic instability does is it takes this quadratic band touching and splits it into two Dirac points. Okay. And the nematic basically is that it can happen in three different ways on the triangular lattice here. Or you can open a gap by creating a quantum anomalous Hall instability. But this is different because, and that happens because you start with a problem that has time reversal symmetry and it has the C6 symmetry of the triangular lattice. Right? But there you don't have it as a critical point. You just say, well, I'm going to switch on interactions and it's going to go into some phase, that the starting state is basically unstable. Right? This is different because now we are saying time reversal is broken to begin with.
It's a ferromagnet.
It's spinless fermions, but no, but that's not, no, but you also break time reversal in the sense of not just, you break both orbital and, because you have spin orbit coupling, time reversal is broken completely, not just in the spin sector, but also in the orbital. Okay. So now you have a phase transition between two different phases, and this quadratic band touching problem is not the non-interacting sort of problem, it's the problem at the critical point. So you have to fine-tune to get to this quadratic band touching. Right? So in this papers by Kibeltson and Hongkong and others, they're kind of, this original paper, they kind of looked at the fine-tune point in some sense was having a quadratic band touching with time reversal symmetry. You force a certain symmetry to be present. But if you don't allow that, allow that symmetry to be broken to begin with, you can still have quadratic band touching appearing at critical points.
I was just this M vector, M that you wrote down there, looks like that transform is a vector.
And, yeah.
And so why is this a nematic?
So this is a nematic because the way I've written it, it looks like it has, it doesn't matter what direction I point in, but in fact the free energy does know about so there is a pinning. So it's a vector, you know, the way I've written it's a vector, but it doesn't have O2 symmetry. Yeah, so the free energy or the energy in this case, if you work out at zero temperature, does depend on the direction in the plane. So there are only, you know, six directions that are equivalent. But of course this is not the pneumatic, this is just the magnetization that I've written down. But what you really care about is actually only the you know, M in some sense, M and minus M will do the same.
So is there a physical difference between M and minus M?
No. So you can point in three possible directions on the triangular lattice, and then you split the quadratic band touching into Dirac points in three different places. And that's the only symmetry. So you get a pneumatic, and then there are these, you know, crossovers that appear. For instance, you can ask, well, is there a mean field? For example, in mean field crossovers, one can define as saying, is there a finite temperature where the mean field, you know, where the bands in mean field theory actually have a band touching? So there is some crossover one can define here. But really, other than this pneumatic order, there is no finite temperature transitions in this particular form. So here we see, possibly the simplest example of this kind of a metallic quantum critical point. In this case, it's kind of trivial in some sense that you can sort of just work it out by hand. But it's kind of interesting that it gives you this physics of, you know, trying to drive a system towards a critical point, but then there is a new phase that kind of shows up.
So does it matter if it's a positive band that is a quadratic triangular triangle? So if you say, if my outband is a triangle, and it's say, if you match, would it be like the same extension of the
curve? I guess yes, although I suspect there might be some peculiarities associated with that, but yeah, so I know that's, you know, in certain models that's kind of just like cadomy or something that happens, you get sort of quadratic bands touching at the gamma point touching flat bands. I suspect the physics might be slightly different from those, but I haven't thought enough about it. So let me, maybe I'll skip over this. I was just going to, you know, give some, so let me actually skip. I was going to talk about sort of paddles and liquids, but I think that kind of take us far up at this point. So there are, I mean, so one thing we've been doing more recently is asking, you know, if you take these quantum anomalous Hall insulators, but imagine, you know, putting some kind of interaction and making it extremely strong, you would be able to drive it into a Mott insulator phase. And then there's this question one can ask about, you know, is the, you know, how does the fact that you have a topologically non-trivial state, you know, do you expect that the Mott insulator you will get will end up being some kind of a spin liquid? And maybe I'll just kind of state the result and kind of not, you know, if people are interested to talk about it later. So we start with some kind of a model of the sort I talked about, where you have two different, you know, you have bands with Chern number +1 and -1. So the simplest example you look at is some kind of Halding model, for instance, on the honeycomb lattice, which has this kind of picture, but it's true also of the, you know, kind of models that I was writing down earlier. And now imagine instead of one spin species, so imagine it's not spin polarized, but imagine I have two copies, spin copies that I can put in. So I can have spin up or spin down. Then you can imagine filling up this lower band completely so that you're at half filling in the sense of having exactly one electron at each side. Now, so what you start off with is a topological band insulator, and now you can keep cranking up interactions. Of course, nothing is going to happen when interactions are small, but when interactions are very strong, it turns out you'll get some magnetically ordered Mott insulators. Okay. And so what we've been asking is, you know, do you get insulators, Mott insulators that, sorry, you'll get Mott insulators, and the question is, you know, does that Mott insulator actually have magnetic order, or is it some kind of a spin? And so what we've been doing is, you know, together with my student and postdoc at Perimeter, we've been kind of looking at, you know, exact diagonalization, DMRG sort of numerics of this. And what we find is that, you know, if we just crank up interactions in the very simple, you know, Haldane model on the honeycomb lattice that spin up and spin down, we find some kind of tetrahedral non-coplanar order where there are spins that organize on the lattice such that, you know, every spin points towards one of the four corners of a tetrahedron, and if you have a spin pointing, you know, let's say along this up direction, its three neighbors point along the other three directions. and then you can sort of trial this on the honeycomb. And so that's a tetrahedral ordered state which has very large spin chirality, scalar spin chirality. Namely, S1 dot S2 cross S3 is large and non-zero if I take any triple of nearby spins. For example, if I take the green, blue, and red here, you know, they all have a very exactly the same spin chirality for any nearby triple. So this is some kind of a skirmion crystal if you want to think about it on the lattice. And now what we've shown using EDNA is that you can actually frustrate these non-coplanar orders. So you can take the skirmion crystals that form from starting from a quantum Hall insulator, switch on interactions, you get these kinds of non-coplanar crystals, and now you can frustrate these with additional interactions and melt them. And when you melt them, they actually give rise to a chiral sun liquid. So there is, in the exact diagonalization, one finds that there are two low-lying states here with a total churn number, a many-body churn number 1, and then some band of excitations here. And then within the DMRG, one can actually compute the nature of the excitations in the problem and show that they are actually anionic excitations. So we've been sort of trying to think about how to understand this transition between so it's a state which is so unlike the states that were mentioned in the context of the iron arsenides that Eris talked about, where you can start with stripe-like magnetic states which have 0 pi, pi 0 order, and when you melt the magnetic order, you're still left with this nematic order that knows that the C4 symmetry is broken on the square lattice. Unlike that, these are magnetic states which are ordered, but if you remove the magnetic order, imagine you take some long wavelength fluctuations of this and the magnetic order goes away, basically there are no other broken symmetries left in the problem. So these non-coplanar states, they smell like things which, if you could melt them, they would become spin liquids, which are completely uniform. They also look like things where, if you could sort of melt them and this large scalar chirality survives, in principle, then you may be able to stabilize the chiral sun. And it turns out that that's kind of a reasonable expectation. So this kind of one model we've been working on, which kind of shows this transition, and we're trying to kind of better understand the nature of the transition between this liquid and the crystal. But let me sort of, if you're interested, we can chat about this later. So let me just leave my conclusions here, and then thank you.
Logistical things. One is we're not going to have a poster session tomorrow, so you should grab your posters. And I think there's actually someone else is going to be using that hallway tomorrow, so if you don't take your posters down, you don't have to search for it. We'll have it somewhere, but take it there. And then the other thing is we're up in 700 Clark Hall tomorrow. Go up the stairs, up the elevator, shouldn't have a problem, and have a wonderful evening. I think the rain has stopped, from what I could tell. I'll see you all bright and early tomorrow.